have nothing left but destruction. But destruction. But destruction. But destruction. But destruction. You have nothing left but destruction. But destruction. But destruction. But destruction. But destruction.
Ralph Echemendia is a world-renowned cybersecurity expert, known internationally as the Ethical Hacker. For over 20 years, Ralph has delivered training on hacking and other security information to corporations including Google, Microsoft, Intel and even NASA. Ralph took his talents to Hollywood and has worked with award-winning director Oliver Stone on films such as Savages and Snowden. He has also worked on other projects such as the film Nerve and TV series Mr. Robot. Welcome, The Ethical Hacker.
All right, looks like it's working now. Hello, 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 hello. All right, so let's make sure this works. All right, so we're going to talk about hacking a bit here. I do a lot of talking around hacking, and especially with my association with Oliver Stone and having worked on Snowden and now having a new venture of my own based in Tallinn, Estonia, which is pretty close. And so let's talk about hacking from a very high-level perspective. So I've kind of categorized this in three different ways that I can say that from my perspective are some of the big problems with computer hacking. Well, number one is the ridiculous cost and the numbers that are being thrown around when it comes to these breaches and what these breaches are costing organizations, and ultimately what these breaches are going to cost every single one of us, because those type of numbers are going to roll downhill to every individual. So, you know, you've got things like saying that every minute over 1,000 people get hacked around the world, and the annual economic cost of this is, you know, in the $300 billion to $1 trillion range, right? These are crazy, crazy numbers. Now, I can tell you, I've been doing this for a long time, and I remember that it wasn't that long ago, maybe no more than maybe 10 years ago, that they didn't even really have solid numbers on cost of breaches. But I'll give you some more on what these costs are as we get into it. So the other thing is the Internet of Everything, as I call it. Everything is becoming an Internet-connected device, and so we have now so many more devices, with Cisco basically saying that we're going to have something around 50 billion devices connected by 2020, which is not that far away. And again, we are very much dependent on this technology and on all these connected devices. The more connected we get, the more dependent we are. And it's kind of funny, most people don't even remember a home number, if they even have a home number anymore. So it's kind of crazy just how much we rely on the internet and how much it's now grown to be pretty much everything around us. I've even seen a connected stove. And of course, this is not just all these type of consumer type things that we play around with, but this is just every industry. This is healthcare. This is retail. This is, you name it, banking, so on and so forth. Then we got the fact that there's a serious, serious shortage of computer security experts in this field, especially in the area of management. So not many people, most people who get into computer hacking are really bad with people. They're not very social. They don't really interact very well with other humans, and that's why they spend a lot of time with computers. So this is a difficult issue to deal with when we're dealing with management, with moving people into the management roles who really understand what it takes to secure and defend against these type of breaches. But when you look at some of the information up here, recently, actually, Forbes wrote an article that said that there's over a million cybersecurity jobs available in the world that go unfilled every year. So beyond the ones that are getting filled, over a million jobs every year worldwide that are not getting filled, which means there is effectively zero unemployment in cybersecurity. So if you're wondering what field to get into, It used to be that the highest paid people in tech were database administrators. For the most part, they used to be the highest paid, and certain programmers. And now it's cybersecurity. In fact, in certain cases, cybersecurity professionals make more money than some executives, which, trust me, the executives don't really like that too much. And the other thing is that because of this, not both on just the management side, but also on the technical side, there really isn't enough analysts who understand what these tools are doing and what they're seeing in these devices. So you can go on, you know, there's lots and lots of security technologies out there. One of my problems with them is that they are all intended for people like myself to be able to use. They're all in terminology that only a cybersecurity person can understand, a technical person can understand. There really is nothing out there for the average person. So, and even those tools, and there's some great tools out there, like the British company that makes this tool called Dark Trace. It certainly has brought the analysis of looking at traffic and potential breaches down to, you know, minutes where it used to be days. But it still takes a real analyst behind that tool to be able to tell what they're looking at, and more importantly, how to act upon it, because it's really all about impact, right? So, Hollywood. So I've spent 7 years in Hollywood, and I've originally started with the idea of, oh, how do I? I'll give you a little more background. So my entry into Hollywood was because I have friends in the music industry, and so I'm privy to hanging out in the studio a lot, and that gave me knowledge about how the studio and production environment worked. And then one day I got a call that said, hey, we need you to get on a plane and fly to Detroit, because there's this little rapper from Detroit who got hacked. And this little rapper was Eminem. And so I had to go there and basically now be more of a forensic expert and figure out what was happening, because there was music that was never supposed to be released, that was not supposed to even be released for months. And that began this path into working with a lot of Hollywood names. And originally the idea was, well, how do I apply my knowledge to the production process, because in Hollywood, at the end of the day, it's just a file, too. These cameras, it's just a file. Everything's just a file now. Everything's digital. So there is no film. The whole process is ultimately digital. So that was the original concept, and that started me to build, you know, started me on the path of building some technologies to make it easy without actually anybody having to install anything, which comes from some previous background. But the funny thing, this was 6-7 years ago, easily, since, and I did this talk in Hollywood called Hacking Hollywood. And one of the things I did was I took an audience member and I hacked them, live right there. And then ended up turning on the camera and microphone at their assistant's office to show how easy it could be done. Because a lot of this information was public. But the funny thing about it is that at the end of the day, they didn't really do much about it. There's certain studios like Disney, as an example, is very, very tight on how they do security in general. But as a whole, Hollywood really hasn't fully gotten it. Most of their focus is mainly on what they call piracy. And piracy is really more about copyright infringement. It's not so much about content protection in the way that I thought content protection should be. Because at the end of the day, another little movie I worked on was Twilight, for you teenagers in here. You know, here you're spending $300-400 million, which ultimately produces some files. And that's really the end product of all of this money, is some files. And yet, there is no IT security or an IT department on a movie set. And I found that to be kind of interesting. And then, not much longer, within a matter of a year or two, Sony got hacked. And I can tell you, because I've done work in the past for Sony, so back when it was the PlayStation hack took place, and I could certainly see this coming, but what I couldn't see coming was the impact that it had. And again, impact is really what security is about, and more importantly, safety is really what security is about. Security is only a component of safety. And this is how unsafe, ultimately, Sony was that they pretty much took the company to its knees. They could not operate at all, whatsoever. They were literally back to fax machines and paper. They told employees that they should not even use their own phones. I mean, they were completely pwned, as we call it in the hacker world, right? Then you had HBO, Netflix. One of the interesting things is ransomware has hit a bunch of Hollywood names. And the interesting thing is the FBI, in some cases, has had to say, pay the ransom. There's no way around this. So that's where Hollywood really is with a lot of this. And, you know, more interestingly, I worked on a project called Snowden. How many of you have seen Snowden, the movie? All right, cool. All right, so, and there it was a little bit different. Number one, I had to be able to provide Oliver means to communicate with all of the parties involved, including Ed. And so all those communications, and then once we got into production, all of the actual assets of the movie, and we created a system for that. And that was just one very small aspect, as really that was a big aspect. But the other was I was even more heavily involved in the writing process. So I actually worked with Oliver and Kieran Fitzgerald, who was the writer, to make sure that, you know, pardon my French, that this wasn't bullshit what was being written, okay? And not only that, but what they were putting on the screens and how we could ultimately translate that to the viewing audience, that this was actually going to be something that kind of made sense, because at the end of the day, people were going to see this. Who worked at the NSA? And we don't want them to look at it and go, that's complete bullshit, even though Hollywood is Hollywood and entertainment is entertainment. But during that time, Oliver also spent a great deal of time with Vladimir Putin and did this whole six-hour documentary series on interviewing Putin, right? And this was all around the time that, as you guys know, we have this president named Trump in America now, and all of these different accusations came back and forth about Russia hacking the U.S. elections and so on and so forth. Now, the interesting thing about this is because in the past, the only time you would ever hear the words Russia come up as it related to a computer hack, it had to do with credit card theft. It had to do with, you know, really, you know, mob, mafia type of things, right? Rarely did you hear Russia being blamed for politically related hacks. It was always China. China has hacked everything. The truth is this has been going on way before computers. Computers are just another tool. And yes, of course this is going on. But whenever you get state-sponsored attacks involved, they're very difficult to actually prove. And of course, in most cases, when you do have somebody who's going to say this has been proven, it's usually been proven by a company who is also a major contractor for either the Russian government or the American government, right? So this is the first time over the last couple of years that we've now seen hacking become even bigger news on a political, geopolitical scale, right? So now you got to keep in mind, when I talk about the lack of resources in this world, many of those resources are being scooped up by the governments. If you do something wrong and you get busted for doing something illegal, there's a good probability you'll be probably working for the government. And if you don't, then there certainly is a lot in the professional realm, but cybercrime as a service still continues to be a growing field for hackers. So one of the ways I like to explain hacking and hackers, but more specifically hackers, is, you know, that there's really four kinds of people in the world, and we're all one of these kinds of people. And number one, there's the optimist, the people who do, and the people who know. They know how to do things, they know about things, and they do them. And then you've got the trusting people who don't necessarily know, but they still do and they still try. And that's really how all hackers start. Because for the most part, hacking is about how to learn something deeply and really quickly, right? So, you know, I don't know anything about a trombone, and I'm going to learn the trombone inside out in a matter of weeks, right? That's the idea behind anything. Now, so you have the people who know and do, in other words, the optimists, the people who don't know but do, and then you have the people who basically know and don't do anything about it, and then you have the people who don't know and don't do anything about it. And those are the four kinds of people. And ultimately, it's these first two types of people that, for the most part, are many of you, in a business sense, who neither don't know about something, but you're still doing something, or you know a lot about something and you're doing something, right? So you can categorize people into those two, and hackers are those type of two. Now, the thing is that ultimately, the weakest link in the whole hacking chain is really us. And so I'll show you a little old school Hollywood hacking here. Now, you might need audio for that.
So let's go back.
Ready? Audio.
What's the password?
Password?
No.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5.
No.
Do you have a dog?
Yeah, her name's Muffin.
Is a password Muffin?
Yes, it is. Come on in.
The funny thing about it is this is still true today. Today, the majority of how everyday people get hacked is now through a mix of social engineering online and offline, right? So because we now trust so much what the computer says, this is even easier to do because I don't even have to be in person. It used to be that the most effective method for social engineering, for hacking a human being to make them believe and think something that, hey, I'm with the phone company. It's easy to do. And it was really easy to do on the phone, but now you don't even have to do it on the phone. It's very easy to do via email and using websites. People trust what they see, and they don't really understand it. So one of the ways I like to kind of get you guys to attend, and this is actually an exercise that a friend of mine, Pete Herzog from Barcelona, another hacker friend, put together some years ago, and I've been using it for years because it is a way to explain the mind and thinking behind hacking. And it's also a good thing that you all can use for everyday business. So it's really good for new hires. If you're interviewing people, this is a good way to see if the people you're talking to are creative, more creative in the way that they think. So so we start with something, there was a bunch of these different exercises. There's this thing called the OSTM, or the Open Source Security Testing Methodology Manual. And this is a framework, if you will, for how to do security testing. Security testing is the professional term for hacking. Okay, so and so the only difference between being, you know, you hear these terms, white hat, black hat, gray hat. You know, I believe we're all gray hats because if, you know, you might be very ethical about something, but if somebody put a gun to your mom's head and said, do that, then chances are you'd do that, right? So everybody's gray in, for the most part in some way. But ultimately, the mindset is pretty much the same. And the way that we go through the process of doing this is pretty much the same. So we started with these Jack exercises, and there's several different versions of Jack. And I don't mean that Jack. I actually mean Jack the electrician. So in one of these is, and again, keep in mind you can use this, especially for in your business, especially for things like new hires. So the idea is you're an electrician, and your name is Jack. And you have a light bulb on the ceiling and a switch on the wall, and you have to 10 different ways to turn off the light. So can anybody tell me a way to turn off a light? You yell it out. Flick the switch. Okay, flick the switch, break the light bulb. Close your eyes. Watch out, that guy's kind of creative. That guy's definitely creative. So far, I mean, we've come up with very quickly, usually within a matter of seconds, you can come up with 5 things to just about any question. What's that? Yes, if you rip out the wiring or, you know, hack the power grid, watch out for that guy. These are the types of things you're thinking through, but the whole thing, and I'm using this light bulb analogy as an example, but what if the question was, how do I get his password? There's 10 different ways to do that, and you really have to think through that. The first 5 are going to be very simple to do, and that's usually not where the answer lies. So some examples are, okay, you click the switch, okay, great, you break it, you cut the wires, you can overload it, you can shut the power, you can. This is where you start getting creative. You can create more light. So if I put a 200-watt bulb next to a 20-watt bulb, you won't be able to see the 20-watt bulb. And people don't think about these things, but think about it when we're applying this to technology. You can wait. You know, very rarely do you get the answer of don't allow anyone to touch it, don't do anything, it eventually will die. That's one way to turn off a light. You can ask Alexa these days. Supposedly Alexa can turn off lights. You can cover it, and yes, you can close your eyes. But these are all different ways. Now, when you think about this, apply this to technology, and think of the fact that any website out there has probably anywhere between 4 and 12 different technologies behind what you see as a web page. Okay? Their stack and the amount of different code behind that, every one of those is just one light bulb to a hacker. And what it really is, like I said, it's about learning about something very deeply and very quickly. Right? So only when you understand what it takes to build a light bulb, what are the components of a functioning light, so on and so forth, then can you actually say, okay, now I can actually properly describe the light. That's one of the biggest problems hackers have. Like I said, communication skills are great on a computer, they're not great between people. So explaining how all this goes down is not necessarily what we're the best at. But we can do it very technically. And then once you really go through this process of deeply understanding how a light bulb works, how you can make that light bulb, you know, how you can turn off the light, only then can you really understand from a security perspective, again, cybersecurity, how to secure the light. You can't really go at it from the perspective of, I'm going to go buy a bunch of products, because you don't even understand what you're actually trying to secure. So that's a process, like I said, that you can use for any number of different things. Now, one of the things that I'm very passionate about is that I've spent 25 years working in what we all know to be a B2B world. It's all business to business, right? I realized that other than my mother, who calls me for tech support all the time, I've never really done anything to help consumers. And yet, everybody asks the same question after every one of these talks, or if we're talking outside, what can I do to be safer? And the truth is nothing. If you're just a consumer, there is nothing you can do. Currently, there is no tools for you as a consumer, because here's the thing, we are all consumers first. And if you're in the technology industry, you're a consumer and you're a creator, but you're a consumer first. The CEOs that are in this building, the CTOs that are in this building, or whether they be the CEOs of American Express or Visa or MasterCard, are still consumers of an Apple iPhone. They don't own Apple, they don't have anything to do with Apple, maybe they have some shares, but they're all consumers first. And many of those companies, like your companies, then create products. So you're a consumer and you're a creator. You're both, okay? But nobody's really looking at the consumer and focusing on the consumer. In fact, one of those examples is, I worked for one of the companies that first did cloud computing, what we now call cloud computing. And you know what we called it? Colocation 2.0. Anybody know what colocation is? That's putting your servers in a data center. And we were a data center. And so virtualization came around, and we were using virtualization, and somebody came up with this amazing term called cloud. And so now we're all on the cloud, and the truth is that there really is no cloud. All this means is now it's somebody else's computers it's on. It used to be I had to go put my computers in the rack. I had to configure all that stuff. Now I can just provision 100 computers with a click. And most people don't understand what that means from the perspective of, you know, what are they responsible for and what are you responsible for from a security perspective? They're the infrastructure. You're the application. And there is a lot there to be under. For example, what if there is an actual legal case? We have a situation where somebody used your resources and it's a, you know, federal case. What do you do forensics on? Where's the hard drive on the cloud when your actual data is across potentially multiple countries? And which laws apply when you're dealing with that? So the cloud is an interesting one. Again, this is just a matter of understanding that now your data is actually on someone else's computers. And you know what happens with that is that we tend to think that this is a computer problem when I said this is really not. This is a human problem because behind the computers are still humans. And wetware is what we hackers call them. You've got software, and you've got hardware, and then you got wetware. Why do we call you wetware? It's because you're wet on the inside. The truth is, web-based social engineering is still the most, is right now, you know, running rampant and wild. Ransomware and all these type of things are all based on web-based social engineering. The truth is, you can patch technology and you can patch a process, but you can't patch human stupidity. And unfortunately, by default, we tend to be a little stupid and trusting and believing, and especially believing in technology. So, let's look at this real quick as far as numbers. Like I was telling you, they say there's 1 million jobs open out there for cybersecurity professionals. And let's look at some more of this kind of stuff. So on average, guess how long a hacker is inside of corporate systems or your computer or your phone before you find out. What do you think that number is? 229 days on average before the company finds out that they've been hacked. And at that point, you only find out now because they are legally bound to have to tell you. When I started in this business, I worked for many companies that got hacked and didn't tell their customers because they didn't have to by law. But now they do. So when you find out about it, that hack is really old. Sony, as an example, which we talked about, was probably hacked 6 months or more before Sony found out. And in case you didn't know about the Sony hack, you know how they found out, right? They came into work and everybody's computer said, "You've been hacked." Now, by the time a hacker does that, they've got it all. And in this case, they had it all. They had so much of it that your backups were hacked too. So if you thought, "Oh, we'll just go back." No, you only have a few months of backups, and all of those are hacked too. So on average, what would you think the cost is of something like the M&M case? That was several $1 million. Because the moment you've got hacked, that's not a technical issue anymore. That's a legal problem. And now you have to engage through the legal system, and we just become expert witnesses and forensic investigators. So it's a very different world once you've gotten hacked, and it's a very expensive one. In fact, on average, the cost per company per year is $7.2 million when it happens. And the average time to resolve a hack, in other words, to actually fix it, is 27 days. Again, you can be on the other side of that, like Sony, where that literally took months. Probably 6 to 8 months before they were fully operational again. But on average, 27 days to actually resolve whatever the heck the hack was. So we do need to do better, and we can do better. And the whole thing is that you can do better in every aspect of whatever you're working on, because we're all here working on different apps and trying to do different things. But very rarely do we really think about, we're concerned about security, but security is sort of like that bouncer guy at the club. You know, you don't really want to deal with that, you know? It's like, if I can get around the bouncer guy, I'd rather go down the other door, right? And security is literally that way. The moment you say security, that means it's going to affect the functionality of your product. It's going to make it less functional in some way, or it's going to affect the performance of your product. It's going to be slower. So, of course, we don't really want to deal with security at first. We want to deal with security at the end. And, of course, that's why this comes up. So, there's certain things we can do better, like understanding how to discover vulnerabilities, and more importantly, how to discover exposure. Exposure is not the word we tend to use, but that is really what you should be looking at. There's a very big difference between somebody like, say, a Microsoft, as far as exposure, and a healthcare company. You know, Microsoft is what every hacker in the world wants to hack is Microsoft Update. Why? Because if you hack that, you can update bazillions of computers at one time with your hack. What's necessarily the motive? Once we get into motive, that's very different. So understanding the exposure of your environment, your application, so on, is key. The other is actually putting security testing, hacking, if you will. You know, we have things like, you know, chaos testing. How many of you have heard what chaos testing is? All right, cool. So we got some developers over there. This is important to do because it's kind of like hacking. It is a good way to actually apply that to the quality assurance and testing process of your applications. Throw everything at it. Let's see how it reacts if we throw every possible bad thing you can throw at it. And that should be part of your testing. Unfortunately, that's never been the case. It is more now, but it's never really been the case in the past because everybody's about get the app out. We need to make money. So it's a first-to-market type of thing. Finding intrusions, finding new attacks. You know, the word new is something that we throw around all the time, but most of the time we're not really talking about anything new. We're just talking about rethinking of something old in a new way. But when I say new, I mean new. You should see some of the things that, you know, we've seen. I've got a colleague who we met playing PlayStation. Tony Hawk. Anybody know Tony Hawk? PlayStation? All right. All of a sudden, Tony Hawk was doing things that we've never seen Tony Hawk be able to do on PlayStation. And so we started a communication with this guy, and it turned out he hacked Tony Hawk, the game. And then we said, hey, great. Well, can you hack something else other than a game? And he said, sure, what? I said, well, here's a website. Come back to us, show us what you can do with this website. And this website ran PHP. So a couple weeks later, he came back, and he hacked PHP, not the website, the programming language. Any website running PHP now had a 0 day that we could attack it with, and nobody knew it. That's new. New. So understanding and finding intrusions and analyzing data in the sense of traffic, too, is key. And then communicating and collaborating those findings is also key. Like I said, it's something that, for the most part, hackers are not very good at, is communicating and again, really explaining the impact to your business, not to tech, but to your business. And we can do this. Again, these are some of the things that I like to, you know, point out. Is this is really about building resilience. And resilience is about being able to operate even when you're screwed. Okay? Even when you've been hacked, your stuff still needs to work. That's the whole idea. And that's not necessarily how programmers think. They think in functional ways. Hackers don't think in functional ways. They think in ways to take something apart and see what the programmer was thinking and ultimately make it do something the programmer wasn't thinking. So safety, it's really about safety. It's not about security. Security is just a component of safety. And ultimately, all of this that we're talking about, because we're so dependent on it, has to do with the safety of our lives, because they depend on this. If I told you, you know, the word virtual, because I love how everybody throws around virtual reality, what's the opposite of the word virtual? Anybody? Real or physical, right? And the truth is, there has never been a time where that is not the opposite of virtual. We live in a virtual world. It's in your pocket, and without it, you don't exist in a physical world. All of your information and everything that makes you you, what we call personally identifiable information, is in multiple databases, hundreds if not millions of places on the internet right now. And I could pull up Google, and I can't do it here right now because of the way it's set up, but feel free to ask me, and I'll pull up Google and show you how you can use Google to find people's information that's out there, including passwords, on Google. And here's the beauty of it. You didn't hack anything. You didn't actually break the law, because if it's publicly out there, it's not illegal. And that's where every hacker starts, by gathering information. So this is about safety. It's about educating each other. It's about awareness. Again, yes, security. And again, the main thing here is to change the mindset and the way that we use technology, especially when we're creating something, when it comes to secure coding practices. So it is something that needs to be at the root of our thinking, right? And not take the word security away, like I said, because we don't really like the bouncer guy. So this is really about safety. And that is a much softer way to think about it, and it's a much more acceptable way to think about it, but it needs to be at the root of what we do every day. And especially if we are responsible for a product and or service that is being used by many people around the world. Because at the end of the day, any one of your products and or services can be made very unsafe very quickly. So think about it that way. Now, with that said, I've actually out here because my new venture, and still having worked in Hollywood and all that stuff, and I'm still have my hands in a few things out there, I came out here last year and was exposed to this whole startup scene and startup world across the European space. And I have to tell you, having and knowing a lot of people on the Silicon Valley side of things, it is very refreshing. It is very different. And I think that, you know, the European space is, I'm not going to say the new Silicon Valley, it's something new, what's happening out here. There is a buzz, there is an energy. And so as I was starting my new venture, I decided to actually start it out here. So I actually moved Americans to Tallinn, Estonia. I based the company in Tallinn, Estonia, and I decided to actually do something about that question of what can I do to be safer. And so this will be launched. I announced it at Web Summit this year, and basically it's taken all of the knowledge of me and fellow hackers and analysts to automate that, because I love this AI term, which I laugh at, because I call that automation. It's just automating that. Automate that, automate that, automate this, automate that, to do whatever. And you have to be careful with that, because you can certainly hack AI too, right? So, but ultimately, to automate the analysis of your traffic, normal people's traffic on their mobile devices, and be able to very quickly identify when something doesn't look like you, or when something is communicating to places that you might not want it to communicate to. And again, it's about safety, and I've taken a lot from what I've learned on the Hollywood side by turning something very, very technical, raw packet analysis, into a story. So for the writers in here, that's really what it's all about, storytelling. So how do you make it easily digestible for, say, my mom to understand what just happened and what should I do about it? Because the truth is, when it comes to consumer innovation in cybersecurity, there hasn't been any consumer products since the antivirus. And for those of you who think that the antivirus does something, it doesn't do anything anymore. Nobody writes a virus. You know, everything today, data is king. Everything is to steal data. You would never destroy data unless you already stole it. And I'm sure I get this question a lot. Why? You're talking about motive. Motive is not what you should be asking. You should be asking how, not why. And in the how is where you're going to learn how to ultimately be more secure. So with that, I'm going to leave you with a little thing that we put together, since I brought most of my team from Tallinn, and they'll be around, so if you bump into them, and I'll show you a little bit of what we're doing. It's very quick, and that'll do it for me. So audio's on. And thank you, guys. And here's what I'm doing with Seguru. Yeah.